let us in prayer. In prayer, largely because of my precarious condition. By the way, I don't know how many of you know, the word precarious originally meant something that can be managed only by prayer. That was the original meaning of the word precarious. The medical sciences had not developed to the extent to which it has today. Something that can be got only through prayer. As Eliot says, people turn to God only when all other resources fail. Charles Lamb, one of my favorite essays, once said he would like to draw in his last breath through a pipe and exhale it as a pun. He was very fond of pun, quibble, using words with two different meanings. He said, I would love to inhale my last breath through a pipe. He was very fond of smoking a pipe, which was very fashionable in those days. The only pipe I have seen is the water pipe. So he said, he'd like to inhale his last breath through a pipe and exhale it as a pipe. I would say that I would like to inhale my last breath as fresh air and exhale it as a maxim. And I'm also reminded of the French philosopher Blaise Pascal, who wrote a very long letter to one of his friends with a postscript saying, sorry, I didn't have the time to make the letter shorter. Quite honestly, I didn't have the time to shape up this lecture crisply. I say this because I need your help to participate in this in a kind of creative fashion and draw some substance out of perhaps a forest of points presented to you pell-mell. There will be some method in the madness, I can assure you. But unless you are very attentive and participatory, the point could be missed altogether, because my presentation will not be any good. Will not be quite the same as academic presentations that you normally hear. I'm not boasting. I'm only stating a fact. I have never concealed my disillusionment of the approach from approaches promoted by academia, because these approaches are often fashioned at a distance from lived realities. While these theories are propagated with all sincerity and earnestness, they all have still births because of their alienation from what Lévi-Strauss calls the life world. Life-world. Life world. Lévi-Strauss. So therefore, I'm only sounding a note of caution. You have to be very alert. I know after a heavy lunch, it is difficult to concentrate There is a direct historical, physiological, psychological, academic connection between sumptuous lunch and deep sleep. So if some of you succumb to sleep, I have no problem. My only request is that if possible, you refrain from snoring. The reason why I want you to refrain from snoring is that if you snore, you wake up the next person who is sleeping. If you want to sleep, you must let others sleep. Jio aur jine do. So jao aur dusre ko sone do. See, on this condition, we begin. Next slide. First of all, I'll be rather quick. First of all, why a topic like this? Now, it's been said repeatedly that the idea of nation is under contestation. But as far as I'm concerned, there is no room for ambiguity as far as this particular term is concerned. There can be ambiguity about nationalism, but there can be no ambiguity about nation. Nation, in sociological terms, means simply a people group, a well-defined people group. And I want you to remember that the focus, the emphasis, the soul of the matter is people, because that's exactly what we have lost. So my entire attempt in this lecture is to put the present discourse on its head and to bring the focus back on the people. As of today, everything else matters, but people don't matter. A flag matters. The height at which a flag flutters is more important than the plight of 100,000 farmers who commit suicide, or more than 1.5 lakhs of children under 5 years of age who die of diarrhea in rural India because they don't have enough safe drinking water. A flag is more important than 1.2 crores of tribal people who have been displaced from their familiar habitats in the name of development. They are called PAP people, project affected people. Only 30% of them have been rehabilitated after a fashion. Great atrocity. These things don't matter. People don't matter. But a flag matters. Jawaharlal Nehru made it very clear what the flag means. So I will not go into it because that will take me on an elliptical orbit. So when I use the word nation, I'm not referring to the state or the government. I'm referring to the people. After all, democracy is, it may sound like a joke, government of the people, by the people, for the people. Let's all laugh. Where are the people? Which government in this country has actually cared for the people? So people don't matter anymore. Now where is democracy? It's a very pleasant, teasing illusion. I know I'll be arrested tomorrow, but we have to reckon the truth. Okay? So, politics and government matter, but people don't. As far as we are concerned, for purposes of this lecture, people matter first and foremost, and that's the heart of the matter. Whatever I'm going to say is actually from this perspective. If you don't understand this perspective, the rest of what I'm going to share with you will not make sense. The second reason why I thought I would talk on a topic like this is that I have always been concerned about the insulation of the learning process from the realities in the world around. If I may use a somewhat pedantic term, circumambient realities and realities all around us. Now, the funny thing is, From time immemorial, it's been agreed that education is the process by which people are trained to belong to a society meaningfully. I'm virtually quoting from Plato. And the mark of an educated mind is the willingness, indeed the keenness, to apply the knowledge and skills acquired through education to solving the problems of a society. That's what education is. Now, if that is education, how can this process be hermetically sealed from the circumambient realities? That's a question that has always bothered me, still bothers me. Okay? And I believe that many of the perversions that today afflict academia originate in this alienation, this disconnect, which has not worked to the advantage either of education or of the nation, both of which are like Siamese twins. So education has to be seen fundamentally as a social project, and a project in which society makes heavy investments. This is the reason why this college believes that we are under obligation to put something back into the society, and this public lecture series is part of that. The citizenship course was another initiative. I'm glad to say some of my fellow scholars from the citizenship course are present here. They've developed a deep bonding with the institution, and I must tell you that you've been a blessing in my life, and I cherish you as my friends for a lifetime. Now, this is part of a changed understanding of what education really means or ought to be. So, education must be seen, and here I am not saying anything new, education must be seen as a people's movement, not a government's action. You know, in this country, everything is top-down. I have studied various programs. For example, for some years I worked, because of an uncle of mine, in the field of public health, or what later on came to be known as community medicine. Every scheme evolved by the government of India was top down. Nobody really bothered to understand the ground reality. As a result, all of them came aground. They got stuck. And this is one of the reasons why our track record of implementing programs is so very poor. I'm sure you're familiar with this, so I will not go further into this. Now, every document on education emphasizes the fact that one of the shaping goals of the educational enterprise is social transformation. How can you work towards social transformation if you have nothing to do with the society around you? And the more the educational project gets harnessed to the interests and predilections of the market, the more education will become blind to social responsibilities and social realities. And I have to mention this because that's the context in which we are living and thinking of a subject like this. So, social transformation. Now, again, maybe I will not talk about transformation because it is a theme in itself. I will only give you a hint by saying that the real purpose of transformation is to enable a society to attain its true form. Transform. That is to say, a society needs to be enabled to go beyond the form it currently has. Because the form it now has is not the true form. This is why status quo needs to be critiqued. This is the reason why we need to look beyond the status quo. Now, again, I'm sure you know this, of all animals, human beings are the only animal. They're animals. I don't have to prove that. Read the newspapers. human beings are the only animals who can understand a situation not only as it is, but also as it is not. You understand? In other words, we have the imagination and the intuition to go beyond the existing scheme of things, the status quo, and attain a higher state of life and activities, of fulfillment. Okay? And that is very basic to being human. Unfortunately, the educational project today seeks only to domesticate its beneficiaries within the elbow room of the status quo. Young minds are taken up and actually molded hard to fit in within the ambit of status quo. At the same time, when it comes to theorizing, we'll talk about transformation. And we smugly gloss over these things and never ask a question. My only plea with all of you, my friends, first of all, I must thank you for coming. I'm so glad to see all of you here. And I'm glad to see that even my wife has come to listen to me today. I am one of the few men alive today on planet Earth who is heard with respect by his own wife. Whether she listens to me at home or not is a different question. But she is here. So the question of social transformation, now when you look into the history of philosophical thought on education, you find, for example, a person like Rousseau in his very, very influential work, M.I., a kind of pedagogic remarks, saying that the purpose of education must be the perfection of human nature. In other words, there is a need for transformation. When the time came for Kant to make his pronouncements on education, he said that the fundamental purpose of education is to contribute to culture. But there is, of course, a meeting point between the two again. We may not discuss that. So, there is a problem here, which I hope I have merely hinted, which would be appropriate for your further investigation. Next slide, please. Now, I want you to think very clearly with your own decision. Why do we need a vision? To understand that, I mean, I can introduce it in a variety of ways, but today, I'll introduce this in a very, very oblique fashion. Now, ask yourself, how is the meaning and value of everything determined? People think that, why I'm saying this is, many people think that vision is an abstract and airy thing. No, vision is a very concrete thing. And that's precisely what I want to prove to you today. Now, how is the meaning of a concept or a word determined? Let's take some examples. Rights. One of the most misunderstood concepts today is rights. Actually, when people today use the word rights, they do not know that they are actually meaning privileges. Privileges are misconstrued as rights. Now, let me explain. From the Middle Ages up until the time of the Enlightenment, 18th century, there was complete unanimity of opinion that a right has to be conjoined with a function which is socially meaningful. Not just any function. Take, for example, property rights. Now, if you're a farmer, you have property rights. You own property and you have property rights. But You cannot do anything and everything with the property that you own. You have to cultivate your property in order to meet the needs of the society to which you belong. You can't say, it's mine, I will do what I like with it. I will allow it to lie fallow. I couldn't care less. Your property rights will be questioned. It's only towards the end of the 18th century, particularly in the French Revolution period, because of the reaction against the ruling aristocratic society, and thereafter in the British context, the British thinkers, Bentham and others, property rights were turned into absolutes and interpreted as though property rights were natural. It was for the first time really that this concept was being introduced. Till then, property rights were not part of nature. It was not natural. Property rights always had a sense of function, a social function. In other words, what I'm trying to tell you is that if you have any sense of history at all, history of ideas, you will know that rights always were conjoined with functions. Today, people claim rights without any regard for functions. For example, the right to free think. The controversy that raged here. Free thinking, free speaking, my fundamental right. Now, nobody realized, such being the level of public education today, and I tried my level best to educate people, but failed. Nobody realized that you cannot claim a right without a function. If you separate rights and functions, you do not have rights, you have only privileges. Is that clear? You must have clarity on these fundamental, basic, simple things. The level of bad education that exists today is truly alarming. Okay. Now, the vision that prevailed, say, in the 17th century, understood the concept of rights in a particular fashion. The vision that prevails today understands the same word in a completely different fashion. That is why vision is important. Is it clear? Have I made myself understood? Or take another example, politics. Politics originally meant nothing other than the art of living together peacefully in a city. Its root is polis, which means the city. It refers to the city-states and so on and so forth. So politics was the art of living together peacefully in a city. So if you were to look at or use this word from within the vision of Athens, the Greek culture, the Athenian culture, then the word politics will have a particular meaning. But in today's context, because of the vision that prevails today, politics means the art of the possible. An exercise in sheer expediency. Can you imagine a more monstrous contradiction than this? And because of the prevailing vision, an entire population, the population of a big nation, a subcontinent like India, will accept this depraved idea of politics rather than the healthy idea of politics that existed at the time of its origination. This is why vision is important. Vision is like the control box of reality. It decides what you will understand, what you will not understand. It makes you blind. It makes you hypersensitive. It makes you react. It makes you apathetic. It's a huge problem. Of often we just gloss over these words, a vision for education, a vision for nation. What is this old fellow talking about? Why should he waste our time? But if you don't know these basic things, where is your education? So, now, the outcome of not having a shared vision. My concern is not with just any kind of vision. Because a subgroup can have its own vision, like for example the gypsies. Or a subgroup based on the drug culture, the hippies or whatever. I'm talking about a vision that is nationally shared. Right? Now if you don't have a shared vision, what will happen is public discourse will stop. Now when you look at these television programs, you know, News Hour, Nation Wants to Know, that kind of stuff, nobody knows anything because there is no vision. People are using words with completely different meanings. It is a clash of words. People are throwing words at each other, and because they're not able to throw words properly, they get physically involved. I mean, it's such an unedifying spectacle. And people still sit and stare at these things. I must salute their endurance. I mean, it's a national showcasing of complete lack of education. But we tolerate it because we don't care. We don't understand what is happening. We don't understand what these chaps are suffering from. Unless and until there is a shared vision, what debate is possible? And all that is possible is slapping one another or slinging stones at each other or some kind of a verbal duel or what NDTV calls the big fight. They are honest about it. Big fight, that's called a debate. What is a debate? A big... Where have you reached? This is called journalism. Journalism has its own history. Please look up the history of journalism. It's very interesting. And by the standard or by the understanding of journalism that prevailed, say, in the 19th century or the first half of the 20th century, the journalists of today will look like ruffians. And I'm saying this with all the responsibility I can. Today's journalists will look like ruffians. Now, I'm not the only one saying this. Rajdeep Sardesai calls today's journalism what? Does anyone know? Supari journalism. Supari? Who is Supari? A hired killer. A person who is practicing the art is called today's journalism what? Supari journalism. Just an illustration to make you or help you understand that unless and until there is a shared vision, look at debate in the parliament. Is there anything in common between any two parties? Is it a debate? Is it any wonder that parliamentary debate looks like some kind of a fight, a theater of battle? When was it that you last heard a decent debate in the parliament? Have you wondered why? Yes, I hope now you can understand. All these things, and I can give you hundreds of illustrations, will tell us repeatedly that unless and until there is a shared vision, our life gets degraded. And the social space becomes a theater of war. And one may here make a brief reference to the famous speech by Abraham Lincoln, where he says, a house, quoting from the Bible actually, a house divided against itself cannot stand. That is the seriousness of the theme we are handling. Now, I'll give you an example. When the AAP government came up with this odd even plan, on the very first day, Times of India published a photograph. What is a photograph? Of a person standing with a bouquet to be given to the first person who violates this king. I mean, that's India today. I'm not referring to the channel. That is where we have reached. There is a public encouragement to rebel. I can give you many, many instances, far and near, but this is enough. So, next slide, please. So, a bouquet of encouragement to flout a scheme which is meant for your welfare. Now, in order to make any progress at all, we need a diagnosis. I'm going to attempt a diagnosis of the problem. You know, for my entire lifetime, I taught Shakespearean tragedy. That's why most people think that my life is a tragedy. I don't know why. I fell in love with the genre of poor tragedy. Hamlet, perhaps one of the most philosophical plays Shakespeare ever wrote. He says, something is rotten in the state of Denmark. I mean, that's a kind of statement with universal resonance. Something is rotten in the state of Denmark. Now, we have to arrive at some kind of a diagnosis, some understanding. So, I'm going to argue that all the problems that we are encountering today, I'm not going to take up specific issues because I know in what a charged atmosphere I'm delivering this talk. We have lost the freedom to speak the truth. We are a very free country where we are not free. Such is the reach of our freedom that I cannot speak my convictions for fear of my life. Now, my submission is this. The basic problem with our society and many, many societies in the world is that we have become an accusative society. Let me say this too, this is only water. In my days as an activist, I used to go and attend various meetings, address various meetings on the need to abolish alcohol. And some of the speakers came to speak at these functions properly drunk, so that they can put up spirited arguments. I don't belong to that category, mainly because I can't afford it. Even this I cannot afford. This is given by the public. Now, the idea or the history of an accusative society is not the 21st century. It goes back a long time. You see it in a particularly clear light from the 17th century onwards. I know there are historians sitting here. They will be able to enlighten you on this. For want of time, let me go further on this. What I want to do now is to very quickly identify you for you certain essential and glaring aspects of the accusative society. Again, we'll have to rush through because I know I just looked at my watch and I'm a bit worried. I'm sure you're more worried than I. One important aspect, one of the most distinctive aspects of an accusative society is that wealth alone. There is a play by Ben Jonson, 17th century, called Walpone, in which Walpone begins the day with this kind of exclamation. This, good morning, to the sun and next to my goal. That's how it begins. Good morning to the sun and next to my goal. So the idea of greed being God is not merely the product of globalization. It was waiting to happen. This was something that was bound to come from the West. And it was in the making in the West for a very long time. It is actually embedded even in the Faustian myth, which is one of the shaping, driving forces of the Western culture. Now, when wealth alone matters, what are the consequences? One, you are completely freed from any sense of responsibility concerning others. When I say these things, you can immediately connect to various things that you know. That's called participatory hearing. I shouldn't have to illustrate every point, because time will not allow that. No concern or responsibility for others, no concern for values. You will not allow any value to stand in the way. This predatory pursuit of personal wealth. And there is no limit to it. And of course, there is no responsibility. Then it doesn't matter how wealth is acquired. In olden days, if you acquired wealth through illicit means, there was some opprobrium attached to it. It was not considered a very good thing. Today it is considered a very smart thing. In fact, a person who leads an honest life is considered a dud, or an American expression, dude. A stupid fellow. In which world? In which world does he live? Ye banda kahan se aaya? Ye dinosaur kahan se aaya? This is the problem. Now, this is what is driving corruption. Now, you attack corruption. I laugh. I really laugh my heart out when people attack corruption. Because corruption is only a symptom. The disease is something else. Suppose you have developed some ulcer because of excessive sugar in your blood. Now you go on attacking the ulcer, the unfeeling ulcer. You will reach nowhere. You have to deal with the basic problem, which is an overplus of sugar. All the sugar in the market has come into your stream of blood. That's a problem. So, both corruption and crime are bound to multiply as long as the acquisitive tendency is accepted as the norm and glorified as smartness. This is exactly, for example, Harshad Mehta, who was a titanic swindler, one of the tallest swindlers of our times. As soon as he was released, or what in legal language is called enlarged on bail from the jail, very interesting that these two words rhyme, jail and bail. As soon as he was enlarged on bail from the jail, he was invited by St. Stephen's College. He came and addressed the students here because he was a role model of smartness. Because he could cheat the public of 64,000 crores 20 years ago, it's a lot of money. Isn't the fellow smart? Isn't he cute? Now this is the problem. As long as this attitude remains, my friends, corruption is only going to increase in volume. That's why, you know, under UPA 2, when a certain minister or his wife was accused of embezzling to the tune of 72 lakhs, funds meant for the disabled, A senior stalwart of the Congress Party said, what a shame to say that a minister has cheated to the tune of 75 lakhs. If it is 70 crores, I can understand. I'm not cooking up stories. This is exactly what was stated in public. Today, accepting a bribe of less than 1 lakh is considered very, very self-demeaning. People will laugh at you. You're selling yourself cheap. Moonfali hai kya? You have noted that ever since I started drinking water, my tone has changed. And I have it. Now, acquisition becomes the goal of life and the index of personal worth. For example, let's ask ourselves, how do we choose courses? How do you decide whether you should do economics, English, physics, chemistry, Hindi, Sanskrit? What is it that drives your career choice? What accounts for the popularity of economics? It's only this acquisitive skill. But now English is about to pick economics. In the last admission, economics and English were neck and neck. Why? Because of journalism. There's a lot of money in journalism. The salaries quoted being given to certain anchors will make you faint. So I will not mention it. I have a few more pearls to cast. So, suppose tomorrow, carpentry becomes the most paying job. Third day, you are paid ₹1 million. And St. Stephen's College opens a course on carpentry. What will happen? The best minds will come to carpentry. We don't realize that our intellectual life has been encroached, completely colonized by the acquisitive spirit. We don't realize these things. I don't know if the economics department talks about these things. I'm actually functioning within the ambit of economics now. Not pure economics, but it's called sociology. So, next slide. The next problem with the acquisitive spirit is, and this is a very serious issue, the degradation of roads in the world. Now, one of the saddest things in our country, my friends, the plight of those who work. There are 350 million people languishing in the unorganized sector. They have no security of any kind. They do not know from where the next meal will come. Their children cannot actually study. Their health needs are not met. If you read that interesting book by Amartya Sen and John Gray's called Economic Development and Social Opportunities, published in 1995, Oxford University presented. With the help of authentic data, they proved at that time, 1995, that the government of India spends 20 rupees per annum to meet the health needs of a poor family. Now, we know that poor families are also large families. 80 rupees, these are average figures, 80 rupees per annum to meet the health needs of a family in the middle class. But 800 rupees to meet the health needs of a rich family. So this is the reality. But this reality is always masked. There are all kinds of hidden subsidies. Medical education is a good example. Medical education in government medical colleges is laughably cheap. I used to pay 700 rupees a month as tuition fee for my children when they were studying in Martindale, which was reasonable. When my elder daughter joined Maranatha Medical College, the annual fee became 650. I wrote a letter to the editor at that time saying that this is quite embarrassing. Why should the children of the rich be given subsidized education? Fees must be indexed to income. I'll be quite happy to pay for my child's education. I might be able to pay 10 lakhs, but certainly I can pay 10,000. And why not? That was the only letter to the editor I ever wrote, which was never published. So there's a silent conspiracy to maintain things at this level of fattening the already rich. The entire scheme of things, you may not know this, is organized largely for the benefit of the affluent and the privileged. You remember during the globalization period, the public discourse that preceded the short period, preceded the acceptance of the globalization scheme, people used to justify globalization by using a concept of the doctrine of trickle-down effect. You think of a jar of honey, you fill the jar, and a drop trickles down, and you are allowed to leak. You're a poor man, you are entitled to the trickle down. Now, nobody even talks about trickle down now. The trickling has stopped. Heckling has stopped. Now, these things are happening right in front of you. As young people, you cannot afford to be ignorant and indifferent. So, you know, I would very strongly recommend that you read this classic work by Maxim Gorky, Mother, which is a very heart-rending portrayal of the predicament of the proletariat in the pre-1919 Russia. There is a character called Milovna, the mother of Pavel, and she actually becomes, initially you would think that Pavel is the hero, but it's completely taken over by Milovna. The kind of struggle, the brutality, the degradation, the oppression, the sweat and the blood, the suffering, the anger, and ultimately, most of the members of the proletariat find their refuge in Rika. That's the only hope. Somehow to forget. Or in India, instead of liquor, people commit suicide. By the way, I may offer a casual comment on Rohit Bermuda. I will probably written a piece on it. But I must tell you that I don't approve of suicide. Suicide is not the way. I don't say this because I'm a priest. Yeah, the church says don't commit suicide. That's not the reason. I believe that standing your ground and making a difference, which you jolly well can, is far more heroic than committing suicide. However, I must hasten to add that there are certain contexts in which suicide may be the only unambiguous statement. So I don't want to be too judgmental on this. But by and large, my position is very clear. I don't endorse suicide at all, in any context. Because I know that there is a larger justice at work in the scheme of things. If you can endure, there will be a breakthrough. If you have something in you, and you agonize over it, and you work, you stand your ground, and you don't endorse this oppressive system, you take your stand, you grow, you develop. You do not know how things work out, but a magical moment comes when there is a breakthrough. That's my faith. So I don't valorize or romanticize suicide. But I certainly denounce social conditions, economic conditions, and political circumstances which drive young people to the brink of suicide. That's a national shame. Anyway, then competitive society devastates the moral order of any society. That is why today, when you look for any kind of moral principle in public life. Now, for example, for a long time, we talked about principled politics. What is principled politics? The marrying of politics with moral principles. Now, again, like in the case of the trickle-down effect, nobody today talks of principled politics. When have you read this word, this expression, which was popular 15, 20 years ago in the newspaper, or heard a politician talking about principled politics in the last 5 years? I have not. Because it's been abandoned as quixotic, utopian, impossible, maybe irrelevant. Now, one after the other, they're actually dismantling the very foundations on which we stand. When a society throws away the moral framework, what happens is the society becomes uninhabitable. You can't live in that society. Let me use a parallel. Limitless pursuit of personal wealth in the industrial context, always involving massive violations of norms. Not just in the case of Union Carbide and Bhopal. Every corporate house deliberately, habitually, systematically violates norms. And then they give 2% what is called corporate social responsibility. I call it not corporate social responsibility, I call it blood money. Blood money. There's a place in Kerala called Plachimala. Coca-Cola company came there. This is a beautiful village in Palakkad district. In less than 3 years, they devastated the entire village. The local people have no water to drink. The daily consumption of water by Coca-Cola in Plachimala was 2 million liters. But more importantly, the highly toxic waste product was simply dumped, seriously undermining the health of the local people. Now, it's a huge history. Please read about it. You can get all this information from the next option. Wherever modern industry has gone, local life has been completely devastated. You know, a Martin Heidegger says, you know, there's a classic essay on technology. He says the old farmer also used technology. In farming, you use technology, farmer's technology. But he says the farmer's technology enhanced the land. But the industrialist technology devastated the land. And it is this that has precipitated what we now call the environmental crisis, climate change, etc. I mean, how can you attack climate change if you don't attack this kind of murderous, acquisitive spirit, which nobody talks about? This is why the discourse on integrity of creation, I've studied it from 1982. I've written a great deal on the subject. Stockholm, 1982. Rio de Janeiro, 2002, take the 20-year period. What progress has been registered? It was in Rio de Janeiro that George Bush came and made the classic statement, the American way of life is not up for negotiation. Because the American way of life is built on the acquisitive spirit. And I have more to say on this matter. And as a result, the planet is corrupted and virtually killed. Today in the corporate sector in the United States, there is a slogan. The slogan is, people, planet, profit. 50 years ago, it was the other way around. Profit, people, planet. at least because of the devastation that they themselves have had to face, there is a slight reorganization. The slogan now is People, Planet, Profit. But not that it has made significant differences on the ground, but at least there is a technical, theoretical awareness of the fact that this kind of approach will not work and it cannot be justified. It cannot last. Finally, I hope it is finally, I don't remember what I wrote in this slide. Apart from everything else, it corrodes a human person. You know, you spend a lifetime acquiring wealth. You violate all your moral principles. You corrupt your personality. Of course, you are eminently successful. You are sitting on a mountain of wealth. But who in the world are you? A stuffed man, a hollow man. The disillusionment that this attitude life brings about, and as Reinhold Niebuhr says, people are defeated by their victories and crushed by the burden of their achievements. People are defeated by their victories and crushed under the burden of their achievements. This is the reality. You look around. I mean, think of the huge war between the two Ambani brothers. It became a national crisis. And newspapers were full of it, and all of us were worried because if the two titans did not get along well, India's economy would be completely devastated. India is Ambani. I wish India would become kind. So, what happens is that ultimately all your achievements become empty. In the 60s and 70s of the last century, there was a huge unrest among university students. So what's happening in JNU is not even a footnote to the youth unrest that took place and shook the entire world. From San Francisco to Tokyo in the 60s and 70s. And one of the slogans that they used to shout was this: we have everything to live for, everything to live with, but nothing to live for. We have everything to live with, but nothing to live for. Our life is without purpose. We do not know why we should live. And Eric Fromm, in his book, The Anatomy of Human Destructiveness, gives the instance of a 14-year-old girl who slashed her arteries on her wrist and was taken to the hospital. And the psychiatrist came and interviewed her, asked her the question as to why she did it. You know what she said? Exactly these words. She said, "At least by seeing my blood, I wanted to know that I am alive." That is the human predicament. So Eliot asked, "Son of man, who are you? What are you? Here in a handful of dust. After all that you have achieved, fear in a handful of dust." All this mad rationalism takes you nowhere. You become cheap in the eyes of your own children. I have challenged hundreds and thousands of people in this country. Last 30 years, I have been traveling through the length and breadth of India, addressing groups, millions of people I have addressed. I've asked a question: how many of you can really say that your children despise you? I would also ask a corollary question: how many of you can ask? How many of you have the courage to say no to your child? I have not seen many hands. Instead, I have seen tears rolling down the cheeks of people. Fathers and mothers coming, confessing the agony, the blind agony that convulses them. So ultimately, life is crushed by the burden of purposelessness. That's what the equity society is. Next slide. And now I'm coming to an extremely important issue. The acquisitive society creates the leisure class. And this is the heart of man. And I want you to pay very, very deep attention. Now, I'm using a technical term here. The leisure class in economics is a well-defined concept. What is the leisure class? Now, see, when production increased with the introduction of technology into the productive processes, the Marxian idea of surplus value. Where does the surplus value go? It goes into the hands of the proprietors and, of course, later on, the shareholders, the board of directors, the shareholders. The working class, which actually worked and produced all this, will always be paid a pittance. And the more efficient the productive process became through the introduction of more and more sophisticated technology, the income or the welfare of the working class did not improve or increase commensurate with the increase in production. They were always kept frozen, and all this enormous wealth got concentrated in the hands of a few. And the most significant feature of this class is that they don't work. That's why they're called leisure class. In fact, if a member of the leisure class does anything meaningful, useful, anything useful, it's considered below their dignity. Now, these days you read about, you know, somebody carrying somebody else's chappals or slippers. Mayawati's shoes. Rajiv Gandhi's chappal. Why? Because it is precisely the taste of the leisure class. I'll give you an extreme example. The story of a Polynesian king, where the custom was that the king had to be fed. It was below the dignity of the king to use his own hands to eat food. So there was a person specially appointed to feed him. And this man suddenly died. The story goes, and you get the story from a book called Theory of a Leisure Class by a Dutch author called Constant Rebling. The story is that he died of starvation because he is not allowed to help himself with food. Below the dignity of a king to reach out for food and eat himself. So, I don't know how many of you know the lifestyle of the leisure class in India. It's really a scandal. Occasionally you hear of a wedding on which 50 crores is spent, 100 crores is spent. All kinds of extravaganza. This is what is called, again, technical language. I'm using really technical language. This is called conspicuous waste. You cheat millions of people. You rob the working class. You accumulate wealth. You do not know what to do with it. So you just splash it. Do the most obscene things in the world. An old student of this college told me that when his daughter got married, he hired an Italian artist to do the wedding invitation card and paid the artist $1 million. Just one item in the wedding. An invitation card, printing everything is different. The artist alone is paid $1 million. I'm also a multi-millionaire. When my elder daughter was getting married, she gave me an instruction. She said, "Dad, the invitation card should not cost more than $1 million. So I went to this place where all these people do the thinking. And I went into several of these big shops. I couldn't find anyone who would do it for 1 rupee. And the cheapest I could find was 1.5 rupees. So I had to ring up my daughter and get her permission to finally accept this ₹1.5 card. Now you tell me, what is the difference between this 1 million card and this ₹1.5 card in terms of quality of life? What reference does it have? What is the motive in spending this huge amount for an item? This is what is called conspicuous waste, which is a feature of the leisure class. The leisure class image is sustained and has to be sustained by conspicuous consumption and conspicuous waste. I was invited by an organization in Gujarat, in Ahmedabad. It's a club of industrialists, extremely rich people. For some strange reason, they wanted me to address them. It's about 3 years, about 4 years. So in the course of my address, I referred to an illustration called the coffee mug, which I used in the assembly game. My speech ended, and then one of them got up and said, "Sir, last week we chartered a plane to go to Singapore in order to buy teacups. So we feel now very embarrassed. What do we do with these cups?" So I said, "Donate it to the students. Don't worry, the donation never comes." So people do not know how to spend their money. What do I do with it? Conspicuous waste, conspicuous consumption, a mad culture. So the problem then is that there is a vertical split between the neo-rich, the immensely rich, and the ordinary people. This is why insecurity stops the modern life in our society is today hag-ridden, haunted by insecurity because of this problem. See, you go to my house now, you will see that it is left open. I have no insecurity because nobody can take anything from there. I have nothing to lose. And I got married about 200 years ago. I told my wife that a house should be such that if a thief gets in, he should leave something behind. So we have never had a thief visit us. What I'm saying is that the kind of insecurity that people experience today is because of this, the vertical split. Now, and even sadder for me is the consequent devaluation of work and the worker. The worker is always looked down upon. And a person who does no work is looked up. This is what is called the DVIP. He does not go strong, he does not understand. I don't expect you to understand. If you don't know this, how in the world are you going to solve the DVIP? You don't want to really abolish the DVIP culture. You belong to it. So it is a hobby to sit and bark about it. Therefore, you have no need to understand the actual ground realities and the operating logic of the social ills. Next slide. Now, the coming into being of the leisure class is not the only problem. There is a consequent problem. What is the consequent problem? And this applies to all of us. Now I'm into the concept of racism. Much of what I've said so far is from history, spanning a period of at least 600 to 700 years. Now, especially because of the influence of the media and the greater visibility, you know, page number 3 of papers and all the rest of it, the social class, the glitterati, the, not the literati, the slipperati, the glitterati. Now, the leisure class generates a pressure on others to emulate them. Which is a good one. don't have the means to live like them, but I want to live like them. Let me be contextual. There are a few I know among the non-teaching staff in this college who have neck deep in this. Neck deep. Or maybe more. Nose deep. Sometimes I feel doing this. I mean, it's pathetic. It's tragic. It's a nightmare. And first of every month, they're on the run because the vultures are after them. They're predators. People from whom they have borrowed a lot of money. Lakhs and lakhs. Because they want to emulate the higher power. And people commit suicide. When you know that you cannot pay back the loans you have taken, what do you do? There is a suicide in this college. But nobody makes an attempt to understand the underlying principle. Some chalk survives hell. 2 minutes silence. And it is business as usual. But this is ridiculous. This is not how an academic community should function. We must understand the problem. Alright, so the pressure to conform to the ways of conspicuous consumption and conspicuous ways established by the leisure class, who are always looked up to by people who have no understanding. Actually, they should be laughed at. They should be deemed as objects of pity because they are poor specimens of humanity. But we look up to them and we take autographs from them. If not autographs, photographs. So because of this, the temptation. Now, a word about the teaching domain. Historically, all over the world, I'm not going to say anything specific about my colleagues from there. Historically, the teaching class was put next to the leisure class. But without the resources required to emulate them. Now, if you actually see a teacher doing manual work, you'll be shocked even today. Am I right? Many students have been shocked seeing me doing manual work. If a priest is seen doing manual work, all the more. And actually, I should have come in my priest's cassock. You know why a priest's cassock is designed in that manner? Why is it that the so-called holy men wear clothes of a certain kind? In every instance, their costume is such that it prevents from doing any manual work. I don't know if you've thought about these things. Have you ever seen any religious leader do anything meaningful, useful for others with their hands? I have. On the other hand, they expect to be served because they are part of the leisure class. So, can you go back in history? The leisure class comprised, first, I'm talking about, say, what is important social anthropology. It's called the early barbarian phase. First phase is the savage phase. Then you have the early barbarian phase. Then you have the late barbarian phase. Then you have the early civilizational state. Then you have the high culture. So in the early barbarian stage, the status of those who did quote-unquote divine service was higher than that of those who provided governance. In fact, a king used to be scared of the prophet. A priest, a pundit, carried so much of power. That's now completely gone because of the economic changes. So, the predicament of the teachers is that we are neither here nor there. So now because of the Sixth Pay Commission, we are almost there. But don't expect anything great from the Seventh Pay Commission. But it generates a lot of pressure, it acts upon us, to conform to the ways of the leisure class, to emulate their ways, to have two cars, three cars, or to have a wardrobe like that of Imelda Marcos. Now, all this is complete nonsense. We don't realize that we are acting not out of our conviction, but out of the pressure that has come upon us on account of the artificial and laughable lifestyle established by the leisure class. Is that clear? Okay. So, in this context, corruption becomes a way of life. But my greatest agony is that corruption steals the bread from the hungry. This country has enough hunger to feed everyone. No one has to sleep on a hungry stomach in this country. No farmer should have to commit suicide. In the last 3 years alone, 1.2 lakhs and 120,000 farmers have committed suicide in this country. As Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru said, India is a rich country inhabited by poor people. That's the truth. So what happens is, the more corrupt a society, the greater the impoverishment of the poor. The poor are the victims. A lot of promises, of course, will be made at the time of elections, but not a single promise will be broken. And that's our political history and culture. So the other important aspect, which is very contemporary, is that the leisure class has always used violence. What was the typical sport played by the leisure class? Does anyone know? Hunting. You read Tolstoy's work, especially Anna Karenina. Hunting was an integral part of the culture of the leisure class. Cruelty is a necessary aspect of the way of life of the leisure class. But cruelty which is directed against others, but they must be protected. Therefore, Tolstoy asks the question, for whose sake? He used to challenge the Tsar. In fact, Tolstoy used to be called the real Tsar of Russia because of his moral authority. He asked the question, for whose sake are we maintaining the army and the police? Is it not to protect the leisure class from the hungry people? He says, people like us cannot survive if the police and the army are not at our disposal to protect us from the hungry people who otherwise would run mad. The situation has not changed one bit. What is the function of the so-called law enforcing agency? So, the leisure class has thriven on oppression, on corruption, on immorality. You know, in every society there were two norms for morality. For the leisure class, the moral code never applied. Promiscuity was fashionable in the leisure class. But among the poor it was a great crime. This hypocrisy was always part of history. So, exploitation. I mean, you read a novel like Godan by Munshi Premchand. You see that? Depicted very clearly and powerfully. Anarchy, including moral anarchy. All these are their essential features. You must expect these things from the leisure class. But they will always use the disinherited, the marginalized, the poor, the oppressed, the exploited, to implement their schemes and projects. War, for example. Take war. In whose interests are wars fought? Have you ever asked? It is not in the interest of the poor. It is always in the interest of the elite, the rich, the leisure class. But who dies in war? Not a single rich man. It's always the poor. I was once addressing a World Conference on Peace here in Delhi. President Abdul Kalam was the one inaugurating it. And for some reason I was asked to give the keynote address. So I said, I have a foolproof formula for ending all wars and for establishing stable and unending peace in the world. So everybody looked at me and said, actually, don't give them that. I'm mad like each one of you. And the good thing is that we don't know we are mad, which is also the bad thing. Every Sunday we realize that we are mad, so that we can become sane in some way. So they pricked their ears, and I said, look, simple. We should have a rule, maybe enforced by the United Nations, that those who decide to launch the war should go and fight. There will be no war in the world. So what I'm saying is that this class, the leisure class, has always used violence, always played with the lives of others, always flourished on oppression, exploitation, hypocrisy and dishonesty. These are the things that you see today. A country is run, ruled, governed by the leisure class. Democracy is a cover-up. Democracy is only an electoral exercise. Democracy comes to a halt as soon as the election commission announces the result. Everything else is taken over by the leisure class. And the nation is designed, custom-made, to meet their interests and protect their interests. By the way, right is defined today as a privilege enjoyed by the individual and protected by the state. That's a classic definition of right. What's a right? A privilege enjoyed by the individual and protected by the state. The state is licensed to use violence. Okay? Only the state can use violence, and any form of violence used by the state is for your good. And all because of this phenomenon called the leisure class. It's like, for you, and it's up to you. See, the problem is my watch is very old, it stops. Okay, now I'm not going to do anything of this. I thought I would take you through the seven evils, or what Gandhi called the social sins. So skip all that, come to the last section that I've been asking. Because, you know, even a principle must have compassion on others. Right? You've been very tolerant, very patient. You have succeeded eminently in masking your suffering. That doesn't mean that I can take you for granted. So, can you come to... Yes. No, one before that. Oh, come down from there. Okay. I'm not going to say anything new now. I have been to a large extent influenced by Bertrand Russell, following you to the philosophy. Philosophy is not a department. You must all read philosophy, but know the limitations of philosophy. Much of philosophy is pure nonsense. No, seriously. At any rate, philosophy is dead. This is not the age of philosophy. This age has not produced any, and after Bertrand Russell, hardly any philosopher. Chomsky cannot really be called a philosopher. He's a linguist. Edward Said was an Orientalist. You name one, you know, philosopher of stature. Derrida, Foucault, I wouldn't really classify them as philosopher. Anyway, that's the question. Now, I'll just very quickly recap for you Bertrand Russell's analysis of identification of the essential ingredients of a healthy society. Our theme is a vision for the nation. I have defined nation from my concept, from my understanding of the nation at the beginning. It's not the state, it's not the government, it's the people. And much of what I have so far said will make a lot of sense when you come to Russell. Bertrand Russell says the very first thing we need in order to lead a meaningful, humane, sensible, meaningful life is a reorientation from the accusative to the creative. Now, what happens is, when you belong to the accusative spirit, your creativity dies. Hello, let me not blow my own trumpet. I'm not a good musician. I tried to blow my trumpet, but nothing comes out. If you look there, you will see a classroom. Right? It can accommodate 42 students and even a teacher. The total expense is less than $50,000. Now suppose that Seaton's College was flush with funds. My imagination will not work in that direction. There are two great blessings that work behind the creation of this novel idea. One is that you have. The second is that it is next to impossible to get permission from MCD, which is considered the most honest organization in the world. Please don't laugh. Otherwise, I'll say they are the most corrupt. Which could be true. So, please understand that your creativity dies. The parents don't understand this. They stuff their children with all kinds of goodies, thinking that they're doing something great for their children. You're actually killing your children. You know, we had to make our own toys. And I never had a toy bought from anywhere. Whatever I played with when I was a little boy were toys I made myself. So I'm rather skilled with my hands. I can do a lot of things with this hand. Therefore, I can understand why Gandhiji said that if he were a poet, he would have written an epic poem on the hand. It's that important. Our imagination gets stultified. Our personality gets ossified, petrified. So, if you don't shift from the accusative to the creative, you will be caught in all the symptoms of the disease that I identified for you in the last hour and 15 minutes. And you will never understand why it is happening to you. Why are you behaving in this manner? You know, I can understand why certain students behave in certain ways. They themselves don't understand. Many people around don't understand. I can very clearly understand. That's also the burden. So, now how does, for example, a student sit in a classroom and fiddle with his phone and the teacher says, please stop it and listen to me. And he shoots back saying, look, I will do what I want. I can learn in 20 minutes what you teach in 20 minutes. The disease is this. You do not understand. I understand. I'm not boasting. I do understand. This is the reason why I was always troubled by the fact that St. Stephen's College had become a sort of club of the privileged. For at least about 3 decades that I know. With all the aberrations that go with it. We denied social justice. We made repeated references to social justice. We denied social justice. Systemically, we deny social justice. And when I opened the door to social justice in 2007 through a well-thought-out education policy, I was targeted and attacked. I'm still being attacked. Thank you very much. I have no problem. I'm man enough to take all that because if I do not have the courage to implement my convictions, it is right that I do it. I die of shame. Remember this problem. Do not get stuck in the accusative. My wife and I raised 2 daughters within this principle. Nothing that even remotely touched the accusative society. One day, my elder daughter asked me, Dad, are you sure that you don't have a television at home? My classmates in Matadei, they have a television. In those days, VCR was a big thing. Some of them have fridges in their own room. We have nothing. answer a question. I said, look, I can give you a collection tomorrow. I can give you a proof. I can give you this. No problem. I'll do it. Do you want that? Or do you want the present way of life that we are living in? I take you out for a walk in the morning and I teach you all. When I come to Mark today, I pick you up and I take you to this table full of music and you learn the fantastic. Then I take you to children's book first, Girls of Shastakamal. Then I take you to the university cricket field, which in those days was accessible. The university was not barricaded that way. It was a human thing. And we run together. We run together. We have a lot of fun. Then we come home and you practice and I stand with you all the time. Then we turn to the art of writing. Do you want this or do you want that? I'll give you exactly what you want. Look at that. Okay. She doesn't have a certificate even today. She's an associate professor in ecology. Don't kill your children. Don't petrify your children. Getting enslaved to the spirit of the acquisitive society. This nation is dying. This nation is in the throes of terminal illness because it has valorized, glorified, deified the acquisitive society. My dear friends, there is a difference between industry and industrialism. I'm all for industry. You know, these subtle distinctions you must understand. People think that industry is industrialism and industrialism is industry. One is the opposite of the other. Let me explain. We all need industry. What is industry? Industry is the use of resources, skills and technology to produce things of use for the life of the people. That's industry. What is industrialism? Industrialism is the exaltation of industry and the wealth it generates to a level of absolute passion. A parallel distinction is between military and militarism. A nation must have an army, the military, right? But militarism is not a matter of maintaining an army. It is a question of a mindset, of aggression towards others. Hitler practiced militarism, not military. Today, we are not at the level of industry. We are at the level of industrialism. That is why it's all being showcased. As though the only purpose of culture, the only purpose of life, the only purpose of a nation is to produce and produce and produce, completely ignoring the fact that it is when production increased that frustration multiplied in history. Throughout history, you see. So, you want to have more of the same disease in order to heal your disease. This is the kind of logic. Now, everything in the country is being neglected for the sake of industry. Now, a brief comment on the land acquisition bill. Why should the land of farmers be taken away from them? Without their consent. I'm going to give you an interpretation. It will get me into serious trouble. But I'm retiring. Let me get into trouble. I was in trouble all the way, so. You know, when you look at the life of a farmer, a farmer has a very special relationship with the land. A farmer's romance with the soil. You know, D.H. Lawrence, British novelist, in one of his novels, he describes a character called Daniel. He's tilling the land. And he says, the soil clung to his feet like prisoner. You understand? The soil clung to his feet like prisoner. There's an organic relationship between the farmer and the land. But the problem is different. The problem is, in history, farmers have been fiercely independent. Whereas, industrial workers were slaves. Abject slaves. They, of course, revolted from time to time. But all these revolts were crushed with an iron heel. I'm referring to a wonderful novel by Jack London titled The Iron Heel. Let's read it. It's fascinating. The Iron Heel. How the working class is crushed. And nothing has changed. If anything, it has gotten only worse. So, we must understand the difference between industry and industrialism. Industrialism makes a nation live only for industry, which is good news for the key, good news for corporate ponchos. I don't know the meaning of the word poncho. I don't know what it means. Are they called poncho? Is it poncho or poncho? I mean, the captains of industry. Today are the captains of your destiny. Everything in a country will now be decided and redefined with reference to industry. No reference to morality, no reference to human need, no reference to social justice. In fact, the moment you talk about social justice, people will get very angry in this circle. I was having a conversation with the chief editor of a very respected newspaper. And I asked him why it was that in spite of the socialist flavor the paper had, virtually very little was being written about poverty. He told me, to be frank, he said, we are under instruction. You will not see newspapers writing about the problem before. You will not see the person, Arnab Goswami, who barks against the VVIP culture, fills this channel only with members of the pleasure class. Have you seen a poor man on Times Now anytime? Not at all. This is the kind of hypocrisy that always thrust upon us, but we lap it up because we don't understand what is being done to us. My dear friends, I really love you because talking to you, my throat is improved. Oh, really? I began my lecture in extreme pain. Now I can go on. Please don't mind. I can go on for the next 2 hours. I'm so happy. Thank you so much. Can we have one more lecture? Anyway, you know, I'm leaving Delhi. So this is the last time of reflection. So, we are on the acquisitive spirit. Time is up. I'm very quickly done. Second, I really don't have the linguistic command to express the importance. Doesn't matter. I know what it is. They think that they can control me. So, cool jaiye. Oh, that is right. If you like singing. All right, now, the second aspect that Bertrand Russell talks about, he says, if you want to create a sane society, a healthy society, you must propagate an attitude of poverty. Today what is being propagated is exactly the opposite. A whole nation is being trained to behave in a boorish fashion. Groups that flout the law of the land behave as though their lives are threatened. The language used is offensive. The style of conversation on national television channels is an insult to the nation. They are corrupting the youth. Parents are disrespected. Teachers are ridiculed. Life itself is foolish. I tell you something. Let me borrow some words from Eliot. Eliot says, once the metaphysical music behind the wings is gone. Once the metaphysical music behind the wings is gone, nothing is left. I wish you would understand the gravity. I mean, I can only appeal to my young friends sitting here out of love for you. The message. Life is sacred. Life is great. Life is glorious. Life is mysterious. Life is divine. Always preserve that sense of wonder. You know, read a novel like Hard Times by Dickens. Actually, a good expose of what happened in the 18th century or the 19th century. How the sense of wonder about life, the sense of mystery about life, was crushed. Thomas Gradgrind is the schoolmaster. His son is Tom, daughter is Florence. They go to a circus, you know, they were not allowed to see circus. Because the watchword, the slogan of the period was facts, 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 nothing but facts. No imagination, don't use your imagination. Stick strictly to facts. That's why somebody says, you cannot question me on facts. He has not read William Manchester's book, Death of a President, where he says, after having done 3 years of limitless research to write this book, Death of the President, he says that I've done everything possible to collect all the facts to make it. I've interviewed all the people involved in this. I have gone through thousands of hours of tapes. I've done everything possible. Then he uses the word, the sum of a thousand facts. Don't question me on facts. That is how shallow people are. You are sitting in front of the whole nation and spouting this nonsense. The people are taking it. At least from St. Stephen's College, some waves should go. Something should flow out of this institution. That's my greatest concern. That's why this lecture series began, and I want to thank my colleagues for taking interest. So, the sense of reverence. And finally, it says, that is so very modern, so directly relevant. He says, every society must give to its members the freedom to express their true being through their work. There's the one freedom that the modern man does not have, is the freedom to express the truth about himself, the goodness of his life, his imagination, his creativity, his abounding inner wealth through the world, because he's straitjacketed, he's stereotyped, he's put in a pigeonhole and made to function like this. I remember visiting Maruti car factory. There's a background there. One day my daughter came from looking rather blind. That's what happened. So the teacher said, my answer was wrong. He said, what was the answer? What was the question? The question was, what does the Maruti factory produce? He only had a van. It was not even an omni, only is a later, next generation. The old van, which was in those days very handsomely and appropriately, which was a red box. So, child wrote the answer. Maruti factory produces van. The teacher said, the answer is car. So I have to take my daughter to the Maruti car factory so she can learn directly what happens. So when I went there for the first time, I saw people working at this in the data station. A worker is given 45 seconds to pick a car. He's reduced to the level of a machine. I couldn't watch it. This is what Karl Marx and Frederick Engels, Marx is even today considered, he's not a fashionable writer in India, especially now, because we are not very far from there. Karl Marx is even today known as the greatest philosopher on human alienation. His cry was that the working class is getting alienated from the work that they do. Let me for a moment take with Anna Arendt. She says, look at the difference between a village craftsman and an industrial worker, modern industrial worker. Take the case of a potter. He selects the mud. He kneads it, makes it a fine paste, or something like the dough. And on the potter's wheel, he shapes it. So from start to finish, he is in the dough. So he experiences the fullness of the process. But think of a modern industrial worker attached to a conveyor belt. He knows nothing about what he's doing. Nothing at all. Listen to the alienation from both. So, Karl Marx talks about other forms of alienation, but subject to force doesn't now stop. Ask yourself the question. And I ask my colleagues today, but do you think you are expressing the fullness of your being through the work you do? I want to say this to you. I did not have that feeling. I had to fight every inch of my life to express something of what was welling up in my heart. It was my heart's cry. I'm not blaming anyone. I'm saying that this is the system we have created for ourselves. That is why I talk about the vision for the nation. I talk about it and think about it as a victim of the scheme of things that we've created for ourselves. Let me conclude by quoting Tolstoy, my most favorite author. He says that the curse of modern life is a conflict between the conflict and the conscience. The context that we have created for ourselves and our conscience. Our conscience is suffocated, killed by the context we ourselves have created. Where is your freedom? What are you living for? Which species do you belong to? What does it all add up to? For God's sake, think. Think. Maybe cry. A person who cannot express himself through his work is not a worker, he's a slave. And therefore, today workers must be enlisted in the large list of what the United Nations calls modern forms or contemporary forms of slavery. We are slaves. For example, and I'm going to close on this example, I got a circular from Delhi University last semester. Not last year, sorry. On the 23rd of December 2015. What did the circular say? It said, organize a speech competition and an essay writing competition, and these are the topics. This is an institution of higher education. As the head of the institution, I don't have the freedom even to choose a topic. How can this be? And nobody understands the intellectual impact. You are expected to function in this straitjacket. The national flag must fly, but it must fly at a height of 207 feet. Okay? What is the significance of this 207? 2 plus 7 is 9. 0, 0. What is all this? But if you say yes, it should fly at 2007, you must also give an explanation. This is the reason. If it flies, for example, at 2007, the climate change can be arrested. Wonderful. Or, at a height of 2007, it will attract migrating birds from Siberia. They will come sit and do their own activities on your head. You must give some reason, and absolutely no reason. I find this funny. I am a patriot. I am a proud Indian. I love this country. And I find India the most stimulating country in the world. Without any doubt. I don't need this drama. As a sensible, rational creature, I expect to be told why certain things have to be done in a prescribed fashion. I'm giving you some of these instances to prove to you that the freedom to express our creativity, our imagination, to our work is gone. At the same time, and that is the hypocrisy of it, there's always the talk about education becoming innovative. Promote innovativeness to education. But you will be told where to stand, whether it is off